So today we're going to speak about beef, as you can see from the title. How many of you knows beef already? Yeah. Okay.
I've developed for it.
Yeah, just do one comment and you got a t-shirt. So, a few words about myself. I'm a security consultant in SpiderLab. We do application security mainly, I mean, now in my team. So from tick clients to code reviews to web apps, pen tests to basically almost everything, reversing and stuff. I really like to host my project in OpenBSD, programming Ruby, and obviously programming JavaScript. If you want to contact me, you can reach me in Twitter or through my website, there is a contact form as well. So, what is beef? Or maybe. Hello? No, not at the word.
Need to turn it up, mate.
Hello? Okay. So what is beef, generally speaking? So every time, for example, that you do a pen test and you find an XSS, HTTP response splitting, or any kind of issue, security issue, where you are able to inject arbitrary JavaScript, what you can do in beef is actually, instead of showing alerts pop up to the customer, or if you are playing maliciously, for whatever reason you could have in mind, instead of just showing alerts or prompt dialogues or stealing the cookie that is old, is an old technique that is not even working anymore a lot of times for HTTP only cookies or anyway methods to detect concurrent sessions that prevents so session hijacking. With beef, what you can do is basically inject a script that contains a lot of functions in a way that basically the victim will execute that script, and you can create a communication channel between the victim browser and the beef server. This allows you to control basically in real time what is happening in the victim browser, with all the limitation obviously of the same origin policy and what you can do in a sandboxed environment like the browser is. So, I just put a few screenshots of beef, so the user interface, some logs, but I will show you a lot of demos, so don't be scared. This is the general architecture, a very high level one. The next slide will cover the basic hooking process. So basically, as you can see, we have a few zombies. All those zombies are also called hooked browsers, and those browsers are actually executing our JavaScript. For example, if you have a reflected XSS, instead of sending a link through Skype to the victim with an alert that will display an alert box, you send a link with the parameter value, for example, with script src, and a link to our hook function, hook file. And when that will be executed, the victim will start polling us. In this way, we can be aware that she's still hooked in beef, so the communication channel is still active. And obviously, that channel that you see there, the polling, is also working on the opposite side. So the victim is polling us, and when we have some content to send, we are sending it to the same channel. So in this way, I don't know if you can see clearly from behind, but point one, you send the hook.js with a reflected XSS, or for example, the hook.js is embedded in a phishing page. The victim requests that hook, retrieve it, and the JavaScript is executed, the beefinit function is called. From that moment, we know all the browser details of the victim, the browser type, version, operating system, plugins installed. The browser are profiled in a proper way, not only with user agent, but actually with browser behavior, so like which objects are exposed to the DOM. For example, if there is an object called window.opera, we know that the browser is Opera. Cannot be, for example, Internet Explorer. From that moment of time, the victim starts to poll our server. In this way, we can know that the victim is still alive until we don't see any more polls. So what happens if you want to send to the victim a new command, for example, a prompt dialogue in this case, just as a simple example. The victim is basically polling, like doing a GET request every X seconds, by default is 1 second, on the hook.js file that is exposed in our web server. So every time she's polling, the content length of the response will be 0 until we don't want to send a comment. So in that case, if we want to send a comment, the response to that poll will be, for example, content length 100 bytes, and basically the response of that will be retrieved by the victim, and what is contained behind the inside the beef execute wrapper is actually the function that will be added to like a stack of comments that are contained in the JavaScript that the victim is executing client side, and basically on this stack of comments we are doing a pop. So we remove the item, we execute the function that was called, that was contained, and actually the result will be the prompt, effectively the prompt dialogue. So this is the outline of this talk. So I developed for Beef a RESTful API, because right now there is basically an admin user interface that you can access through your browser. But obviously if you are doing very malicious things like Tor exit nodes and stuff like that, Ethercap filters, you modify the response and you hook every single response with Beef, you cannot manage it. So if you have like 100 hooked browsers, you cannot manage to click in every hooked browser. So what I added to Beef is a RESTful API. Then also I also added WebSocket support. You know basically what WebSockets is. It's a new stream protocol that was added with HTML5. By default, for example, in Firefox, you can send up to 15 megabytes of data with a single stream. And also, I will show you also a few demos of both of all the three things. And about XSS Race, I will show you also some nice announcements we did. And also, I will explain you what it is if you don't know it. So, let me just show you a very quick live demo of Beef. 1 second. Okay. So we start B. We access the control panel. This is the default user interface. We also have a command line interface that is similar to the Metasploit one. We have in another server, in a virtual machine, we are running a dumb vulnerable Google application. As you can see here, admin password. We log in a different browser. We disable the default protection, so basically the application is vulnerable to reflected cross-site scripting. So if I put like script, you see the cross-site scripting is there. So what happens if instead of sending this attack vector, I actually send something slightly different? So if I send like, obviously this will be just sent through a link, but just for demo purposes. So instead of sending an alert dialog, we are sending actually, we are saying load a new script. And you will see here the browser. From this moment, basically we can know, as you can see here, browser details, so exact version of Firefox, all the exposed plugins, all the technologies enabled, the default cookie. So for example, we already got the PHP session ID, we can do already session hijacking because the application is not using HTTP only cookies. And we also know nice details that could help on, for example, client-side exploits. So for example, if I want to send to the victim a prompt dialogue, say, like, are you who? It will work. Yes. This is still using the old communication channel. I will show you later with WebSockets what will change. So we obviously get also the data that the victim was inputting there. But this is a very lame attack. So for example, what we want to do is we want to steal the credentials, even if we have the session, okay, but just to be sure to get access to that application for the next time. So let me just check the login page. So this is the default login page of the dummy vulnerable application. So what we can do is actually sending an overlay frame. We can render an overlay frame in the victim page. So in the overlay frame, there will be the login page of the application. Attached to this overlay frame, there is also a JavaScript keylogger. So as soon as the victim will see the login page, she will probably enter again the credentials because she thinks that she was logged out. And obviously, we got the credentials back. So if I do execute.
I have a question. Why did you say she? Would you by default that the victim is a she?
Who knows? Who knows? Okay, you see, automatically everything changed. But in the background, we still have the communication channel running. So if I do admin password here, and I do login, this is still content that is rendered on an iframe. And you see here keystroke admin password. So this is just a simple example of what you can do. There are tons of modules and things that can help you in a lot of pen testing scenarios, especially when you can basically do social engineering attacks. So why I developed this RESTful API? Because first of all, I hate SOAP, I hate XML RPC, and obviously, honestly, I don't like technologies that are basically not using, for example, all the properties of the HTTP protocol, but are adding another inner protocol inside it, like basically SOAP is, or XML RPC. So what we can do with a RESTful API is basically code very easily expose services, expose functionality of the application to the outside in a way that basically everything that is understanding HTTP and JSON can contact our service. So from a bash script that is using wget or curl to C, C++, every kind of language you can imagine. And so this obviously is nice to have more integration with Beef. So other tools that, for example, security scanners that want to integrate with Beef and automatically send a hook as soon as an XSS is found. And coding it with a few gems, I don't know if you are familiar with Ruby, but is a very easy thing. So for example, that code is actually returning all the modules that are available in Beef. When it was started with name, categories, and everything. So as you can see, it's like 15 lines of code. And you can really do something like, for example, a request like this, get to a pub beer, please. So basically, when you do a get request on this URI, you get a string response like this with a 200 response. So it's very, very easy to do. Obviously, the code is in GitHub, so if you want to have a look or fork the project, you are free to do it. And for example, another thing that is cool with the RESTful API is that, as I told you before, when you have a lot of hooked browsers and you want to script the exploitation of those hooked browsers, you can do it very quickly, writing, for example, a Ruby script. There are a lot of information here. I wrote wiki pages about that, so every endpoint is well described with examples how to use it. And right now, what I want to show you is actually this. So imagine that you have three, four hooked browsers, different kinds of browsers, so Internet Explorer, Firefox. You want to determine if the browsers are using a vulnerable Java plugin. As you know, the 1.6.0 update 27 was vulnerable to the Reno command execution exploit. So you can inject an unsigned applet and pwn the operating system through the plugin. And we are going to do that. So everything is actually automated. As soon as you have the browser hooked in beef, you just run the script and you get reverse shells. And yeah. Can we turn up this slide? So this is what basically the script is doing. The script as well is in the wiki page of the RESTful API. So if you want to download it and try it for yourself, for your pleasure, it's fine. So we have basically Metasploit loaded with the XML RPC exposed in a way that actually when we run beef, we can contact Metasploit directly. So you can see that we are loading the Metasploit exploits in a way that as soon as the victim is hooked in beef, we can actually inject those iframes that are pointing to the Metasploit URL to launch the client-side exploits. We'll have two victims. One victim is Firefox on macOS 6. Also note that the phishing page that will be rendered by the Firefox browser has a few links. Those few links, so href links, they don't contain a target blank attribute. So this means that when you click on that link, the results will be open in the same tab, not in a different tab. Remember this for later. So another browser that is will be hooked in a second is this Internet Explorer 9 on Windows 7, fully patched, except for the Java virtual machine. So for example, this OWASP wave is an application vulnerable to XSS, right? So you basically hook the victim sending a link. Two browsers are hooked in this moment. Now what we want to do is just launch our script. So the script is actually achieving persistence, so creating overlay iframes, reloading the same resource in order that the victim cannot escape from that page, so it's still hooked. Now we injected an unsigned applet in Firefox, and we are waiting for the Java applet to come back to us with the exact JDK version, because sometimes from the Navigator plugins object in JavaScript you cannot get proper results. So the Java virtual machine in this case was update 31, is not vulnerable to the exploit we are trying to use. We are doing the same for Internet Explorer. Obviously you can code the script with in an event-based or threaded-based way, so you don't have to do it sequentially, but it's just for demo purposes. So no results yet. In a few seconds, we will get the exact version of the Java virtual machine, of the JDK plugin exposed by the Windows 7 machine. It's 27, so potentially vulnerable. and we got a meterpreter session. So, as we determined that the JVM was vulnerable, we just sent, we injected in the page an iframe that was pointing to the Metasploit URL that was actually the one that was delivering the Java applet. So as soon as the Java applet is delivered, we are using a reverse Java meterpreter payload, and we got access to the operating system. Everything in an automated way. Obviously, you can even write a meterpreter script to automate also post exploitation further. It's just up to your imagination, obviously. Before injecting the applets, the thing I told you about the href, as you can see here, the original phishing page was actually this. Something like this, with not this resource, but another one. So if the victim is clicking on this resource, that is a different domain, we don't have the target blank, so this resource will be opened in the same tab. But thanks to the persistent technique that we injected, we basically detect when the victim is clicking on a link, and if she's clicking on that link and the resource is cross-domain, to prevent to lose the hook, we just open it in a new tab. This is a common behavior. For example, every link you got in Twitter is opening in a new tab, so the victim will probably not recognize the difference. Let me come back to the slides. Feel free to stop me during the talk if there is something not clear. So next argument, WebSockets. The default communication channel in BIF, as you saw before, is using a XML HTTP request polling. This is obviously not efficient, and the data overhead is quite huge, because even if the response are always zero, you still need to send the data. If you have Firebug or the Chrome equivalent installed, and you open the network tab, you see all the polling to a different server. That is not the application itself. So it's not even stealthy. But works everywhere. So this is the default channel. What I added is basically something that you get such a huge performance, like in this way with a girl in front of a turbine. So if the browser has WebSocket, it's very easy to detect it because it's exposed as a DOM property. We actually change the communication channel from XHR polling to WebSockets. In fact, this is not still experimental in BIF. I forgot to update this slide. It's already in BIF, the disabled by default. But to show you the difference, let me just... It's at least 3-4 times faster. So, for example, if we come back to the situation of that we had before, so a victim browser, let me first stop B, because I need to enable WebSocket. No. Let me show you the tunneling proxy without and with WebSockets. This is the perfect example, I guess. So, how much time I have left? 20 minutes or more?
20.
Okay, we rehook the browser. And I say use this browser as a proxy. So in this way, what we can do is actually tunnel requests through XSS. So basically, in BIF we have like a server-side socket that is waiting for requests. And for example, if I configure here Opera to point to the local proxy, that is this one basically. this one. 6789 is the default port. Okay. What is happening is that basically Opera will use this the bit proxy as a network proxy. For example, when Opera will send a GET request, Bit will get that request, will pass the raw request, and will translate the raw HTTP request in an AJAX request. The AJAX request will be injected in the victim browser because we can control it, so we can say, do this AJAX request for me, retrieve the content, strip some headers, response headers back like gzip because the deflate, for example, was already happening with JavaScript, and then reconstruct the original response for the first raw request and send back the data. So basically, in this way, we can browse what the victim is. We can write the session of the victim without even stealing the cookie, because the cookie will be automatically added when the AJAX request that we are injecting in a browser are made. So, for example, if I want to load this page, this is with the normal communication channel, so it's pretty slow. And also, it's retrieving also all the JS and the CSS. So in this way, you can see that actually, without having any previous cookie here, any credential, nothing. So if you see cookies, it's blank. We are writing the victim session through an XSS. So to all of you that think that XSS is crap, fuck you. let's do the same thing. Let's clean also the eventual content. Now, if we do the same thing here, enabling WebSockets, so we refresh here, again, use as proxy. And we do a refresh after all the cache was cleaned. Yeah, you can see how it's fast now. And it's pretty much 3-4 times faster because it's a streaming protocol. This is also nice, for example, when you want to send a lot of data through this proxy. For example, there is a video online that I have in my Vimeo account still without WebSockets, but I will upload a new WebSocket one where I basically tunnel BERT, and basically I found vulnerabilities in the domain where the victim is hooked through the proxy. So in a way that if, for example, forensics people want to understand what's happening, they will see the traffic coming from the victim browser until they don't understand that there was the injection. And even if they understand there was the injection, you have your IF server in Latvia or some abuse-resistant hosting, so not a big deal. I'm not saying that you should do that. But it's a disclaimer. Where's Raul? Outside smoking. So yes. There. And the final thing that I want to talk to you about instead is XSS race. So XSS race is actually a JavaScript XSS scanner. So an XSS scanner written entirely in JavaScript was written by Gareth Ice in 2009 for Microsoft, I guess, as a contract job or something. I integrated it in Beef like 1 year and a half ago. So what we can do is actually inject the logic of XSS rays, so the XSS scanner core in the victim browser, execute it, and through the scanner identify new XSS. So imagine that the victim is located in a public website, because you can send the link and everything. But in that public website, there are links to the internal network. And this is quite common, for example, in a lot of enterprise environments, like internal wikis and stuff like that. What will happen in that case is that XSS Race is able to check for cross-site scripting, even cross-domain, without violating the same origin policy. So the original idea of Gareth was, I mean, the whole idea of XSS Race is basically this. So if you have a page with three links, so three href links, with parameters or even without parameters, because you can have URI-based injection for XSS. What you want to do is actually load all those resources in hidden iframes, and try to actually load those resources with an XSS vector. So if there is a link to example.com, you will try, for example, URI injection to example.com/ not existent, like slash blah blah, and then an XSS vector. And what will happen is that if the resource is vulnerable to XSS, that vector will trigger, and Gareth Ice was able to actually get the data from the child iframes in 2009, because this was not limited by the same origin policy. There was still a bug with the hash fragment. So with passing data after the hashtag in the URL, he was able to get content between parent and child iframe. So in this way, he was able to understand while an hidden iframe was able to load the resource and was identifying it that was vulnerable to XSS. This thing was not working at all when I tried it, because now it's patched. You know that browser security is a very challenging environment and everything is changing very fast. Also, every browser has a different security context every time, so it's also difficult to work in Beef and maintain consistency with updates and a lot of things. But we try our best to do our best. So, in order to still have the cross-domain checking for XSS, we basically load what you can see there. For example, if there is a link xt.com page 2 with a parameter mail with a value blah in the page of the victim or in the domain. Right now it's only working in one page, but I will write a JavaScript crawler to crawl the website. You can actually create an iframe that is where the source attribute is pointing to that resource. So that resource will be loaded in the iframe, but at the end of that parameter value, you will put the red vector that you can see there. So script, open, close, and inside the script, you put document location, href, a beef resource. This means that if the XSS will be successfully triggered, the document location of the iframe will be changed to point to a beef resource. So basically, we'll receive a GET request if the XSS will be triggered. This means false positive. This means false positive free. So if you get a GET request on Beef, of course there is XSS. Otherwise, it's impossible to get the GET request. Obviously, it's a false negative prone thing because we are proceeding blindly, and we have various attack vectors with double nibble Lurie encoding and other nice vectors, but you always proceed blindly. So, but the nice thing is that as soon as you get this connection back, you will see, you can be certain that that result was vulnerable to XSS. Otherwise, you don't see anything. The nice thing about that, as I said before, is that if those xt.com, for example, pages, instead of bxt.com is an internal resource, you can actually get an XSS on those resources and then say to the victim, okay, load that internal resource to another XSS on another tab with the XSS that you just found, and so basically your area of attack is expanded. Yeah. And I will show you a demo in a sec. The enhancement from the previous versions are basically more attack vectors, also DOM-based injections, new encoded attack vectors as well. Then we also added Chrome and Safari support. So they are both browsers based on WebKit. WebKit has a basic XSS filter, has a lot of bypasses already, like with SVG tags and malformed HTML entities, but there's also a nice thing. So if you base 64, the frame source, the whole thing will work anyway, because if you use like data URI injections, the XSS filter will check only if the data URI will contain an XSS, like a script tag or other malicious scripts that you consider very bad stuff. And in this case, you will not see anything because the resource is base 64. But as the data URI expect the base 64 value, encoded value, on the second step, when the base 64 will be decoded by the browser, it will be, the XSS will be triggered. So this is still present in the issue tracker, but it's not patched. When they will patch it, we will implement a new technique, it's like cat mouse. We also added Internet Explorer 6 to 9 support. There is a weird bug basically in Internet Explorer 6. When you do location path name, you don't get a forward slash at the end, so there was a nasty bug. Let me show the demo as well. So, now let's be in a different situation. So you have like a phishing page that is basically this. So with the big hook loaded. So as soon as the victim renders this page, she will be hooked in beef. And also this page contains other links for demo purposes. Imagine the same thing with reflected XSS and then other links in the page that you don't know if they are already vulnerable to XSS. So you see also that the IP is the same, but the port is different. So this, for the same origin policy, are two different domains. Okay? So XSS race will work cross domains. What we can do now is, so we load the phishing HTML page. Okay. Then here I also want to show you what is happening on the console. Then I say launch XSS race on hook domain. Yeah, you see what is happening here. There are a lot of debug informations and things happening. So iframes are created loading these resources. And you can see here that we already received array. So basically it means that one of those resources has been found vulnerable to XSS, or even another one. Probably the same resource vulnerable to multiple injections. So you can see here processing vector, the URL that was tried. Sometimes obviously you got bad requests depending on how the application is developed. So when you try URI injection, depending on the vectors you are sending, you can, some requests can fail, but no problem, because this is anyway is shown all in the console. The victim doesn't show, doesn't see anything. So if we go here, XSSRays, we can see the logs. So we can see the vector that was successful, so like the standard script injection double quote. We can see here a POC with the shitty alert, but just for demo purposes. And to confirm that it's not a bullshit, you open a new tab with the POC that we just copied, and this one was again this resource that was identified by the XSSRays loaded in a hidden iframe and then injected. So this name parameter is vulnerable to XSS, and in fact it is indeed vulnerable. So I guess that this is pretty much it. So I want to thank every people that was involved in this. So Wade, that was the original creator, is still involved with us as an architect, and a lot of other coders and people that committed to time to time. Our blog manager, obviously Spider Labs, where I work, because it's like I'm at work now. I don't have to take holidays, and I can be wasted with my friends. And also special thanks to Ralph, Balgan, Tavane, all the organizers, and also Raul, Mike, Tom, Alexander, Porco Dio. Yeah, then if you want to get in touch with me or us in BIF, we have a lot of resources. Documentation, as you know, is not the best as in every open source project. So if you want to get involved with BIF, to get some fame or I don't know, whatever, we will not pay you, but we want your code. So any questions? I don't know if it was too technical. Okay. Thank you very much.